It was a controversial one for this reason. They sewed a kitten's eyes shut during a certain, early period of development. And what happened is the kitten's vision, even after they unsewed the eyes and let the kitten see, their vision was permanently like affected by it, and it wasn't able to fully develop. So it makes you wonder, and like with the feral children, we could take those two together and kind of speculate, are these critical periods in development and infancy where like once you pass them up, you can't, there's no second chance, like once the brain like kind of develops, right? Because we know the brain stops developing or maturing by the age of like 25, give or take. So it makes you wonder, like infancy, like neurons, there's so many neurons, right? And they're going about, right? Forming. So once that brain development passes that stage, whatever, for whatever reason, there's like a stage where we have to develop vision the proper way or language the proper way. Like once the question is like, once you pass it up, is there like no going back, in lifespan development, meaning like when we grow from when we're born to like when we die, that there's these critical periods early on in infancy that once you pass them up, like for vision, for example, or hearing or walking. And once you pass that up, the chances of being able to fully develop that area of the brain in order to be able to perform those behaviors, well, it diminishes significantly. Often, sometimes to where people, where there's been like very rare cases, I think, where those like functions never really truly developed, There's a child locked up or something, and she never really developed the ability to speak language. And even after she was, rescued and all that, no matter how many therapists worked with her, speech therapists and all that stuff, she wasn't able ever to fully learn language, and speak in sentences. Once that critical period passed, they think that's the reason why,
And there's a name for that type of kid, right? The feral children.
Yeah, and to clarify that, that's more of like kind of like children in the wild. That might kind of fit though, because technically she was deprived, right? So yeah, feral children left in the wild to fend for themselves.
Because I've heard of stories such as these. Unfortunately, some kids, they never grow up with anything, almost like as if they were dogs, right? They just feed them. They never talk to them, quote unquote, like their necessities covered. But because they're deprived of, being able to move, being able to walk, being able to go around, and they never develop language. They never develop, maybe even never seen the daylight, that sort of thing, only artificial light.
Yeah, there's an interesting study related to that, like called it's published in the South African Psychiatry Review. It was called A Feral Family on Our Doorstep. And they interviewed feral children, or not interviewed, but they studied feral children, right? So psychiatrists, psychologists, and occupational therapists, a feral child, a child left to fend in the wild without being raised, as you're kind of mentioning. The child was struggling with like bathing, with getting dressed, had trouble using a spoon, needed help with that, right? As you would expect. And what's interesting, the child was still able to show some emotion, like with smiling. So it's like, it's almost like a natural thing that you don't need to be taught. I don't know. And then nonverbal like gestures between like tribe members. So like the idea is that, I guess the child, I'm assuming for now, was in some type of tribe, right? Away from society. So it's interesting, it brings in the question, are emotions kind of natural things, You don't need to be taught that, like language.
The more that we deprive, a child from its basic needs, the more that, they develop deficiencies in certain areas. When kids are not exposed to social interactions, they tend to be a little bit more socially awkward just because they don't know how to actually deal with social interactions on the day-to-day basis.
Putting a child in front of a TV during a really early period of development, and they're in front of the TV all the time, their vision may not develop depth perception as well. I think there are studies on that too, where like, because they're in front of a screen, right? And not in real life, right? They weren't able to, their eyes and brain didn't develop depth perception. So the ability to perceive kind of, The brain needs to develop. I think, so this ties into genetics, and it ties into nurture, like nurture versus nature. Nature's genetics, and then nurture is like being in society, being taught things, being exposed to stimuli, right? So like the TV thing, like I guess what we're getting at is the brain is going through a critical development period to where it needs to learn or needs certain stimuli to enter, like through the eyes or ears or something like that, to make trigger certain mechanisms in the brain. So it's like the environment and the stimuli in the environment is working collaboratively with the genetics and all that stuff in the brain, you know.
Yeah.
Form, you know, those extremely important domains like vision, language.
Yeah. It's almost as if those critical, the critical period, what we call critical period, is probably maybe just the organism or the human being, you know, understanding how, what things are necessary to live in the world that they're surrounded by.
Well, I think it also calls into question, like, why are there certain brain areas that are almost like designed or like predisposed to develop those specific areas? Like there's specific areas of the brain for vision and for like hearing and for like decision making and morality. So like, why isn't that strange? You know, it's like there's a blueprint.